Hi everyone, I'm back with some useful exercises to practice a new topic in signals and systems, which is filters and body diagrams. I'm Gio, an assistant professor at UPF in Barcelona. I'm an expert in wireless communications, and on my channel I upload classes on signals and systems. So if this is the first time you visit my channel and you're studying signals and systems, check out the previous theory and exercise classes. Let's get started with filters and body diagrams now. The first exercise we're working out today gives us an ideal passband filter with a certain frequency response, h of j omega. So if you can, as you can see, h of j omega is non-zero between omega c and 3 omega c, and for negative frequency, so between minus 3 omega c and omega c. So if I want to represent it, it looks like this, like the signal in red, okay? So it's a filter that passes with gain 1 between omega c and 3 omega c, and between minus 3 omega c and minus omega c. So I need to determine a certain function, a certain signal g of t, such that h of t, the anti-transform of this h of j omega, has the following form in the text. So if I simplify omega c with omega c, well, I get h of t simply or equivalently expresses the sine of omega c t over pi t times g of t. So what is the g of t I'm looking for? To find that out, let's recall what the Fourier transform of a sinc function is. In this particular case, we have sine of omega c t over pi t, and the Fourier transform of this is a rectangular shaped signal, which is one only for magnitude of omega smaller than omega c, okay? If you don't recall this, we can just double check to make sure we got the numbers right by doing the anti-transform of the rectangular pulse, okay, which I have expressed in mathematical terms as the difference between two step functions, u of omega plus omega c minus u of omega minus omega c. I applied the Fourier integral definition, and through some manipulations, well, I can express it as 1 over pi t sine of omega c t, which is exactly what we started from. Cool. So once we know that, let's represent this rectangular signal in blue, okay? So as you can see, it's similar to the signal above, to the red one, but this is centered at zero, okay? So what do I need? What do I need g of t to be if I want to go from the blue one to the red one? So h of j omega is given by 1 over 2 pi, the convolution between two Fourier transforms. Why is that? Well, it's because h of t is the product of two things, as you can see in the text of the exercise, so the sinc times g. So because of the multiplication property, a multiplication in the time domain corresponds to a convolution in the frequency domain. So that's why I have that h of j omega is the convolution between two Fourier transforms. The first one, which I have already calculated, and the second one, which is the Fourier transform of g of t, which I indicate as g of j omega. So in that case, the g of j omega that I want will be given by two deltas, because I want to shift my blue spectrum to the right and to the left. And we know that doing the convolution with a delta is what shifts a certain signal in the frequency domain. So first I need an impulse, which I marked in green, centered at 2 omega c, to shift my blue signal by a quantity 2 omega c to the right. Then I need another one at negative frequencies to shift it to the left. The amplitude of these have to be 2 pi to compensate for the 1 over 2 pi factor that I have. So as a result, g of t, which is the anti-transform of this, can be easily calculated. And we know it's given by, for each delta is given by an exponential, a complex exponential. So the result is 2 cosine of 2 omega c t. Let's take note of this. We can verify that. How to verify it? Well, simply, we go on and calculate h of t as the anti-transform of h of j omega explicitly now. So h of j omega is the signal in red, remember? So we can break this down into two integrals that run between minus 3 omega c and minus omega c, and between minus omega c and 3 omega c. So if I just try to solve these integrals, which are simple, I obtain four complex exponential terms. Let's group them in a convenient way, as you see at the bottom left. Okay, so again, we have by the distribution property, we have grouped these complex exponentials. And now I can just rewrite this in a more compact way by noticing that everything is basically a sine or cosine function. So up until now, we've done only manipulations, and then let's identify which term is which. So you see that there's a first term, 1 over pi t times a sine, and this is exactly the first term, which I'm marking in dotted red, in the expression for h of t. And then the second term, well, the second term is the one that corresponds to g dt, therefore. And g of t is therefore given by twice a cosine, because it's a sum of exponentials. So our initial result was actually correct, so we have double checked that. Let's move on to the second exercise, where we consider a real low-pass filter with a certain passband frequency, which is 1 kilohertz, and suppression frequency at 1.2 kilohertz. Okay, so this is expressed in hertz. The corresponding omega, the radians per second, are obtained multiplying by 2 pi, so just to avoid confusion. So I want to obtain a certain filter with response g of t. So in the frequency domain, g of j omega is going to be given by the Fourier transform of this g of t. And g of t is expressed as 2 h of t times a cosine. So I'm going to calculate this Fourier transform. So I know that the product, once again, corresponds to a convolution in the frequency domain. So this can be equivalently rewritten as 1 over 2 pi, the convolution of the respective Fourier transforms. So what is the Fourier transform of cosine of 4000 pi t? Well, how do I calculate this? Well, I noticed that it's a periodic signal, so the Fourier integral would not converge, if you recall from previous theory classes and previous exercises. So the way to solve this is by using delta functions. So the Fourier transform is going to be given by a train of deltas centered at frequencies k omega 0, multiple of the fundamental frequency omega 0, and with amplitude scaled by ak, which are the coefficients of the Fourier series. So in our case, omega 0 is obviously 4000 pi. T0 can be equivalently derived as 2 pi over omega 0 as usual. And what about the coefficients ak? Well, they're the coefficients of the Fourier series. So I can calculate them with the classical definition, which is the integral over one period divided by the period of the signal itself, which is the cosine of omega 0 t times e to minus jk omega 0 t in dt, okay? So if I don't remember the result of this integral and I just go on with the calculations, well, I see that out of all these coefficients, only two are non-zero, and they are the coefficients corresponding to k equal 1 and k equal minus 1. You can see this from the expression we found at the bottom. Well, these are integrals of complex exponential functions over one period. So these integrals are always zero unless the term and the exponent is zero, okay? So this is non-zero only when k is equal to 1. And in that case, the integral is simply 1/2. Or in the case of k equal to minus 1, in that case, it's also 1/2. For any other value of k, the result is zero. So I only have two non-zero coefficients in the Fourier series. And I can finally write the expression for the Fourier transform as pi times the sum of two deltas, okay? Probably you recall that we've seen this before, that the Fourier transform of a cosine is given by two deltas at opposite frequencies, plus and minus omega zero. Okay, so once we've done that, we can continue with our calculations because we now know what the Fourier transform of the cosine is. So I've just replaced it in the expression. What I'm left with is, well, some multiplication terms and a convolution between h of j omega and these two deltas, okay? So let's simplify the multiplication factors. And what I'm left with is two replicas of h of j omega shifted in the omega domain, so in frequency, by quantities minus omega zero and plus omega zero respectively, because that's where the two deltas are centered. Let's always recall that omega 0 is 4000 pi in our case. So let's draw an expression for this now. So this is g of j omega, just to recall it. So I want to draw the original filter h of t, its Fourier transform, which is h of j omega, and I've drawn it in red. So as you can see, the passband frequency is 1000 hertz or 1 kilohertz, and then there's a suppression at 1200, okay? And what about g of j omega? Well, it's going to be two replicas of h of j omega shifted by plus and minus two plus and minus omega zero, where omega zero is 2000 hertz. Okay, sorry, f zero. Omega zero is 4000 pi in radians per second, but in hertz I have to divide by 2 pi, so it's exactly 2000 hertz. Okay. So let's now answer the question that the exercise asks to determine the passband and suppression frequencies of this resulting bandpass filter G of J omega. Well, as you can see from the plot, the passband frequencies are between 1 and 3 kilohertz, and the suppression frequencies are at 800 hertz and 3.2 kilohertz. You can see this by symmetry. Now let's move on to the final exercise for today. So we consider an LTI system that has a certain frequency response h of j omega, but it's obtained cascading two systems, h1 and h2. Okay, so here's what it would look like. We cascade h1 and h2, and then the cascade of them is h of j omega. We know that the frequency response of the total cascade system is given by the product of the respective Fourier transforms, the frequency responses. In the time domain, it would be given by the convolution. Okay, so out of this, we know that regarding the Bode diagram of the magnitude, this product in logarithmic scale converts to a sum. So because 20 log 10 of the magnitude of h of j omega, since h of j omega is the product between two different frequency responses, is obtained as the sum between 20 log 10 H1 and 20 log 10 H2. So that means that if I want to obtain a Bode diagram for H2, I need to subtract H1 from H. Okay, so I can look at the two Bode diagrams that I'm given, and that by subtracting one from the other, well, I have the answer. I will be able to sketch a Bode diagram for the magnitude of H2 of j omega. So let's do that. So here's the plot, okay? So it's the magnitude of H2 of j omega in dB versus omega in logarithmic scale. So from frequencies for omega smaller than 1, which is 10 to 0, well, I have that H is minus 20 dB and H1 is also minus 20 dB, so their difference is 0. Then in this next interval between 1 and 10 for values of omega, well, I see that H is still flat, but H1 is growing by 20 dBs in one decade. So the difference will be decreasing by 20 dB. So I'll go from 0 to minus 20. In the next interval, the slope increases because H is decreasing by minus 40 dBs per decade, and H1 is flat. So the difference between them is a decrease by minus 40. And then if I keep going, in the final interval, I have that H decreases by minus 40, but H1 decreases by minus 20, so the difference decreases by minus 20. So the slope is decreased again, okay? The final value. So in this video, we've practiced Bode diagrams and also filters through some simple exercises. I recommend watching the other exercise videos as well as my theory classes to better understand the fundamentals of signals and systems. And more videos on this and other topics are coming, so subscribe to this channel and you'll be the first one to know when I upload something new. See you in the next videos.